I'm Fred Ruim from Leuven University. I teach information science in a faculty of the humanities, of arts, information science and online publishing. But I was for many years responsible for ICT of all the humanities faculties in the university. And I took a lot of responsibilities towards building a strategy for e-learning. And at this very moment, I'm a counselor to the vice chancellor that has e-learning in his portfolio. So we are working on a new strategy for the university. But the first thing I'd want to do is get your votes on what the motivations could be to develop blended learning, because that's what we want to do, of course. And so I mentioned a lot of reasons why you would want to do blended learning, and I'd like to get your hands up for things that you can relate to. So would you do blended learning for it's fun, it's technology? Do you? Who votes for that motivation? I see you two votes already. For reasons of efficiency, is this a motivation that you relate to also? Yeah, three votes already, four. To improve the quality of learning, would it be a strategy? Yeah, that is very popular. Because your auditorium are cramped and you say, okay, we have too many students, so we need to go move online. Is this a motivation here or not really? To experiment with new pedagogies, is that, that is also a very popular choice. Or flipping the classroom, yeah, that's one or two votes. And or very pragmatic, you say, okay, but the students already voted for e-learning because they are already online and their life is online and their girlfriend is online, etc. And why shouldn't their courses be online? Would that be a motivation following the students? I see some positive signs. Yes, indeed. Other universities do it. I think we can understand that. Or it's a government requirement, and I happen to understand that it is a requirement here in Czechia at the moment, or it will be. No.
It's not like this, but when we want to have the organize blended learning, it's necessary to have online support and online materials prepared, or some materials. It's the change now. Yeah.
Now, I think in Leuven, it was double. So in our university, there was the motivation of the staff to improve the quality of e-learning, of learning, and to work with new pedagogies. That was the motivation of many of the professors that wanted blended learning. But we sold it very differently. So that's why I came in. I'm not a pedagogical person. I'm an ICT person. I sold it to the university as being cheap, efficient, good for the market, etc. So that was how we broke through at the university level. We said, hey, it's just a good solution. Yeah? Your auditoria are totally crammed, and we can expand on the cheap with blended learning. So that was a good selling proposition, whereas we had much difficulties to motivate senior management purely on pedagogical arguments. Because one of the things they said was, hey Fred, but pedagogies come and go, and now you're here with student-centered learning, but what will be the hype next year? So come back when the hype is over and we will talk again. But these arguments that really went into the efficiency, since we are a very large university, multi-campus, we have about 85,000 students throughout the region that we have to serve. So it's a little bit, that was the selling proposition, let's say. And now, the enabling factor, what really made the difference was that we convinced the university board that you need to include the teaching performance of your academic staff in the evaluation of the careers. So, and I think Jeff made the same point. Once you say that academics are not only evaluated on their peer-reviewed journal papers, but also on their teaching performance, that gives young people a motivation to do this right and to professionalize themselves. So I think that was really the key enabler to get things moving. And this means that today in Leuven University, we offer a platform where young professors can build an education portfolio. So they can upload examples of their teaching and their teaching innovation. They could, for example, upload that they won a prize for innovation, like we saw the example in Edinburgh. And this is part of their evaluation. And this stimulates indeed some innovation. But this means that, of course, if you say the staff will be evaluated on their teaching performance, then you need to give them also some opportunity to learn. And that's why we have many support in professional training. It all started with ICT, so I taught a lot of classes myself to fellow junior professors about how to use technologies. But then came in the pedagogues and the psychologists and the sociologists, etc., to really enhance the training of the staff in these kind of things. For example, we had psychology professors explaining how to manage groups and group work and how to divide roles and to monitor roles. So we had for each innovative teaching strategy, we had experts that taught some classes, and it's for free, so any professor can enroll. So we would announce a class, we would say, okay, in the summer there will be a course on student-centered learning or ethical questions in teaching, for example. We invite an expert, and then people can register and follow these classes. And having followed these classes comes in your professional file, and you and could play a role in your promotion. Now, our focus was on on-campus learning. We have a lot of campuses that we have to serve. So our focus was not so much on really truly online courses. So most of the many courses that we put online in this online learning system, you couldn't really follow as a finished product. It's always a support for a traditional teaching lecture class you see that we had similar phases as the ones that Jeff explained. So we had an experimentation phase where a lot of professors worked with Moodle, with WebCT, Blackboard, etc. And so they gained some experience. And then with a group of academics, we wrote a letter to the rector's office and we said, okay, but we need now some serious action, some serious support for that. And then in the second phase, and I was the president of the committee that did this second phase. From 2001, 2006, I was the chairman of this Toledo, as we call it, which is the e-learning strategic platform. And we decided that we would use one platform for the whole university. It was a very tough discussion because at that time you had the commercial companies like Blackboard, etc., and you had Moodle coming up, and other open source platforms. One of our competing universities in Ghent, they invested in an open source development. So they developed their own software. And this meant they hired about 8 people in that time frame, and it were all engineers because they wanted to develop a learning platform. We decided to buy a learning platform, so we negotiated with Blackboard and we implemented Blackboard. And so our team had only 4 engineers and 4 pedagogues. And the interesting thing is that we had a better reach than the competing university because we had these pedagogical people who really motivated staff to innovate the teaching and to get it done. And so we put less effort on the technology but more on the pedagogy. Now, the other university, Ghent, also had benefits from their choice, because working with an open source environment always has good points and good, there are good reasons to do so. And of course, they could make more innovative stuff. So when we look back, they certainly did some more innovative things, while we had a more upscale and more impact. That's the difference. But then we deployed it to 13 university colleges, to 13 other university colleges. We deployed this environment, and now we do MOOC pilots. And I'm currently revising the new e-learning policy for the university, but it is still under embargo. But I can say you that it will just intensify what we are doing. We will do more on MOOCs. And we will do more on the personal learning environment of the student. So what we think is, until now we had this, it's a kind of offer. We offer to the students a learning platform, and we offer to the teachers the support, etc. But we think that in the future, the student will make his own learning environment on his portable and on his devices. And we see that many savvy students really organize their portable, their laptop very well. And it's a kind of mini library where they have their courses, etc. And this also drives the demand for online courses. So we have professors with magnificent printed books. And then the students say, can we get the PDF? Because on the PDF, we take our notes and we link it to other information that we have read. And I saw some examples by students who are breathtaking. So their laptop is really a kind of mini university with their papers, the papers they have read, the comments that they make, the chats with their friends, the group work. And so this is something we want to facilitate more. But for that, you need that all your course materials are online, of course. That is something we will move on to. So our environment is based on the Blackboard LCMS, and a very important stuff, but maybe not so relevant for you, I'm not so sure, is that we made the decision to integrate it in the core ICT of the university. So when I came in office, we had this large ICT team which made the university registration, the accountancy, the official reporting, all these kind of systems. And I said, but that's strange that you have the same ICT systems than a supermarket or than a kind of company, a bank or whatsoever, and you don't have ICT for your core activities. And so one of my dreams was that the university should develop ICT for learning, teaching and research. And I focused on the learning and teaching, and colleagues of mine built an ICT platform for research, which is more difficult because research goes in so many directions. This is something you cannot do from a centralist. That doesn't work. And so there it is more an approach where it comes from bottom up. Whereas in teaching and learning, you can do it more centrally. And that's what we did. And so it's integrated. When a student registers himself for a study at our university, he is automatically enrolled in all the online courses. And each course that is in our catalog is an online course. And so all professors have, whether they like it or not, they have an online course. And the nice thing is that the students in the beginning, they noticed, hey, there is an online course for this class, but it's empty. And so they complained, and they said, this is strange. We have a class on history of the Middle Ages, and there is a fantastic online course. And then we have this course on history of modern times, and there is nothing. There is a book somewhere in the library. And so the students complained about the professors who didn't have an online teaching. And we always felt, if you cannot convince the management, go to the students. And I did this several times. I will come back to that. So use the students as a driver to innovate. And then we find it important, Jeff already mentioned the library integration, we found it important to integrate ICT with the infrastructure, with the classrooms, with the teaching spaces. And in the UK there are many universities that have invested a lot in what they call learning grids, learning spaces, where students, often it is managed completely by the students. So in Warwick, for example, it's a student association that manages the space for the students. So the students really are the owner of their learning spaces. It's not the case in Leuven, we do it ourselves, but we built something like that. Now, Toledo has all these functionalities. I think you recognize them. Maybe an important thing that we are working on is the online exam environment. We have a complete online exam facility where you can take exams online. And for the moment, we use this for the marginal situation. So normally, students do a classical exam, a multiple choice or whatsoever in an auditorium. But for specific groups, for example, students with impairments, students that are at a distance, students that cannot come to class, etc., we offer this complete online exam environment, which we think will give us expertise for the future. So we, in ICT, I always think 5 to 10 years ahead. I think, what kind of capacity do we need long-term future? That's here you see something about Toledo, and this is the way it looks. So these are my courses, the courses that I teach, and they are some of them, and I teach a lot of courses, but you get a portal as a professor of all your courses online. All of these courses have announcements, etc., the documents. And then, as I can maybe switch to the role of being a teacher myself, I used it in the master's, of course, but also in the bachelor level for undergraduate students. And so, why did I do this for the course in information science? Well, it's about computer skills, because it's a class that prepares people for the classes in statistics, etc. So I learned them to treat information rightly. How do you work with information? And I thought, well, it's a skills-oriented class, so I need it to be on the computer completely. That's why I did this. And you see, these are the ways I use this environment. And for me, one of the important things is to reduce the number of lectures. So I give less classes, because I have a lot of classes to teach. If I would do that, my week is full and I don't have time for research. So what I do is, I only give once in the 3 weeks a class. And I say the rest is online, and you do it online, and so don't bother me again. I'm doing my research, or I am in Pilsen, visiting a very nice city, etc. And the students can continue their work. That's the whole thing. So you have a forum, etc. I also use web environments outside of the learning environment to experiment. But there I notice, I'm a web specialist, but I notice how difficult it is to manage a learning environment outside of the university structure. The security, the privacy, the protection against hackers, spam, that is so much work. it's my field, and even I would give the advice to people, never do that. Go to your information system specialist of the university. Do not do what I do here, put up a known website. That's very dangerous work. But you see, I make a lot of videos, and we have two ways to do this. Your laptop with Camtasia software and a good mic. So I bought a mic of maybe 300 euros or so. I have a good mic. And so at home, I just record the classes. Or I can, when we do a serious course, for example, we are building a new course for the whole faculty on information science, and there the recordings will be made by a professional service. But any teacher can start making YouTube films, of course. YouTube is full of these kind of educational movies. And I have my own YouTube channel that I use for that. So I upload a lot of movies on YouTube that people then can, for example, here all on Excel, and you see that I also like fast cars, visibly, but okay, that's something else. But and that's the trick a little bit by using social media. Okay, and students, since it is skills oriented, students also produce content. And that's very important that they produce online content. This can be content for the courses. We had a famous example of a course on philosophy in the First World War. It was a class that a philosophy teacher in our university taught. And part of his online classes are recordings of the classroom experience. So it's student-generated materials. That's quite interesting to experiment with. Now, what were my as a teacher? What were my challenges and benefits? The design effort is extreme. I don't know if this is also your experience. Is this your experience also, that it takes a lot of time to make an online course? Do you have experience in that? Would you vote for that option? So the design effort is, and this means that you need a professional team that can assist you and that can help you to design a real professional course. What I find very challenging in the undergraduate is to really get student engagement of high enough quality. Because we all know that they are on, they are not on Facebook, they are on, what is it, WhatsApp and all this. All this social stuff, but it's not very, very deep. So students are very acquainted with digital tools, but making an effort to really learn things deeply, I find this extremely challenging. And so pure online, it's difficult. We see, for example, when we do really online courses like MOOCs, that the participants are somewhat older. I think you agree, Jeff, that participants in MOOCs are often 25 to 35, 50 and higher. And these are mature students and they participate. But undergraduates, that's a difficult thing. But there is a lot of benefit. Less teaching hours. I think do not do the blended learning if you keep giving all your classes. That would be foolish. Then you do a lot of extra work that doesn't pay off somehow. So you need to reduce the contact hours and say, okay, the rest you will do at home in your PC with the online course. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense, I think. And then my online exam saves enormous time. It took me a lot of time to build it, to build the database with all the questions, etc. But now it saves me enormously in time. And of course, I do real skills deployment. It's not just theory about computing, but students work really.
You talk about online exams. So your database of items is online, but the student still has to travel to an exam center, or can do it online as well? So
no. No, for my undergraduate, they do it in exam rooms. So they come to an exam facility. But we are in the process of trying to implement the technologies that they have now developed for the MOOCs, like in Coursera, etc., where you can have an identification of the person online. But that's not a real situation now at the university. And it's a pressing thing because exam rooms are expensive. Eh? That's expensive. So if you can get rid of that cost, but technology is not really mature because you really want to make sure that it is the right student, not with 10 consultants at his side that is doing the exam.
The online items are.
And then, of course, the other, because if you develop blended learning and you make all these efforts to build online courses, you need to change the way students get in contact with this material. So normally they get in contact in your classroom, but they should also have social spaces where they can learn together with the online material. And this is like this learning space is exactly that. And you see here the you see that the student can book a room, can book equipment, and there is a lot of software to work collaboratively. So that's and you see here the learning space. We had an old building that they wanted to destroy, and I then convinced the university to transform it in a learning space for the students. And they book the rooms, they can arrange things, and they can share big screens, etc. And so these students, they ask for online courses. They say, okay, but we are sitting together, we are learning here, and to hell with these books, we want the videos online, etc. Now we also have a pilot infrastructure, which is again a learning space, but more limited, where together with industry, we develop new technology, screen technology mostly. In Belgium, there are a lot of engineering about visual technologies. And so we built a lot of technologies for learning in collaborative ways. For example, this is the thing that I use. I put students together in groups and they need to prepare something that they then show to the whole group. So this big screen can be shared to all other big screens. And you have the groups, they prepare something and then they show it to the other ones and I can discuss it with them. That's what we are doing. So that's an experiment that I run with students at one of our campuses in Courtrai. Which is totally flipped classroom. And there I replaced the exam. I just said, okay, you make an individual homework and you publish it online.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I just ask your definition of flipped classroom?
Well, where you do not teach yourself, but where the students are working with the materials and get a learning experience and share it with each other. And then get in a discussion with you to of course, get them to the right path and to. But that's how I see the flipped classroom. And Now, the support services, I think Jeff gave a very good overview about how you could do this. So we have two that I want to highlight. That's one service at the rector's office that is all about staff professionalization with pedagogues, psychologists, teacher trainers, and they make sure that younger professors get, they won't invest in old guys like me, there's no interest in that, but for the younger people we train them. And then we have invested heavily in a video production unit, in a top-notch video production unit that makes all these knowledge clips. And what they will do is, they look at a traditional university class, for example, a course on maths, And they will go through the material with the professor and they say, okay, but you cannot put a video of 1 hour, someone writing on a blackboard mathematical formulas, that's not online learning. We will make small clips that explain the reasoning. And so these are really course engineers. These are really course designers and they help the professors. I think any university should have such a unit. I think that's the way you produce now. It's no longer the professor who writes a course. It's a professional team that produces a knowledge thing that is part of courses. And that's a worthwhile investment, but it costs some money. And you see the services that they offer. It's a whole range of services that they offer to us. Then maybe the very last thing that I want, because I'm talking and talking. The very last thing is the importance of analytics. So it's not something that you can do overnight, but once you have all these online courses, you can get data from that. And for example, my videos, I can really track. Suppose that some videos you really see that in the midst of a video, everyone stops watching. Or they are tracking back. We also have videos where you see that the peak is at certain points and for the rest. So we are really studying. I hire assistants to look at these data. And then they will say, hey, professor, the third video in your series on Excel pivot tables, there is something wrong there because they are going back and forth and they stop the video. And then we look at it and we correct the video. And this is something that in traditional education you cannot do. You give a class, you do not know, you have no record of what happened. Maybe half of the room is asleep, didn't catch in the beginning the formula of the math professor and they are totally lost, but you don't know. Online, you know everything. And you need to pay people, because you cannot do that as a professor, watching all these analytics data, that's silly. But we hire staff to do that. And they will come to us and they say, hey, this video doesn't work. And this is the learning analytics. I think many universities are heavily investing in that. Okay, that was my story. Took a lot of your time, but we can move forward.